Most of the people who have heard of the Klamath Basin know it as the home of Crater Lake, the only national park in Oregon. But as breathtaking as Crater Lake is, it is just part of a magnificent and unique ecosystem of mountains and marshes and streams and lakes. And at the heart of this Klamath Country is a mighty forest of more than a million acres, but our forest is dying. For untold ages, this forest had thrived as an intricate and beautiful web of life, woven from the interrelationships of hundreds of plants and animals. The great monarchs of the forest, giant ponderosa pines and firs, would rule for centuries, then slowly falter and fragment, leaving snags to house the birds and bats, and finally fall and enrich the forest floor. And living together with these towering trees were whole galaxies of smaller creatures. There were young trees vibrant with life, and baby pines planted by forgetful squirrels, wild strawberries and chinquapin, and a whole melody of other plants and insects. The leaves and seeds and cones and flowers fed the chipmunks and rabbits and the butterflies. In order to take a closer look at what is happening to this beautiful area, we visited Craig Bienz, the Chief Biologist for the Fish and Wildlife Program of the Klamath Tribe, and an expert on the ecology of the Klamath region.
The unique geology and climate have created here a special environment that does not exist anywhere else in the world. We can recognize that in a variety of different ways. Part of that is the interest that scientists have held to this area. Geologists, biologists, zoologists, a variety of scientists have looked at this area to try to unravel all the unique features that it represents.
And the forest was home as well to a whole world of birds, gray jays and stellar jays, tanagers and hawks, and more reclusive inhabitants, like the turkey vulture, living in a cave high on a hillside while it waited for its new feathers. There was never just one kind of forest, but forests to fill the many niches created by the Cascade Mountains meeting the high desert. In some places, fire had shaped the land as well, leaving stately ponderosa pine and open ground. In others, the pine still ruled, but the understory was richer. And the forest, with its many faces, was home to the porcupine and the bear. And the beautiful mule deer. And among the great trees fluttered the big-eared bat. But the web of life that is the forest is beginning to unravel. and our old forests are vanishing.
So it's historically and probably geologically very unique in that being a great lake at one time, as that lake has disappeared and then come back and then disappeared and then has come back and then is actually disappearing again. As that change has occurred over time, there have been species that have been isolated. So we have some fish species, as an example, that exist in places that probably were connected at one time to the Columbia River Basin or to Lake Lahontan to the south. We also have other terrestrial type species that have isolated themselves here. The fish probably represent, or the aquatic species, I should say, probably represent this the best. And that's where we have the short-nosed sucker, the Lost River sucker, those types of fishes that have existed for thousands of years in this basin and are now on the verge of extinction. That process of extinction has been greatly accelerated because of man's activities in this area.
And for thousands of years, the men and women of the Klamath tribe were part of this great round of life of the forest. They lived along the rivers and marshes in brush wickiups in the summer and earth-sheltered lodges in the winter. They fished for suckers, salmon, and trout, and picked huckleberries and gathered seeds and roots. They hunted the deer and harvested the seeds of the locust, the yellow pond lily of the marshes, and they were one with the earth that sheltered and fed them. They left their sign upon the earth, but it was a gentle sign. The oval hole where the winter lodge had once stood, or a broken lance point, or rocks piled up during a vision quest.
The change from the past to where we are now is very easy to see. It's easy to go out on the ground today and find large clear cuts, harvest practices that have been excessive to the point of obliterating natural species, natural systems. This process has been going on for less than 100 years. Probably, I think 1907 was the beginning of forest management in the Klamath Basin, and that was mostly on the west side of Upper Klamath Lake. It's hard to think that in less than 90 years we have completely removed certain species from this area, that we have failed to understand the significance of those species and the interrelationship they have with the environment. This has been brought about largely by the desire to harvest the trees that were here because of the high economic value. But it was also brought about because of the failure to recognize the unique ecological features that are represented in the Klamath Basin. And again, I would mention that natural ecological diversity that existed here is unlike anywhere else. And so the system functioned in a complex manner by providing ecological diversity rather than successional diversity to maintain the diversity of species that are represented here. With forest management, the ecological diversity was removed. Now, generally it's thought that you can't change ecosystems or plant community types or the potential of a site. But in fact, in this area, we can show many examples where by harvesting in certain ways, by tilling the soil to prepare it for tree growth, we have actually changed the capability of a site. We've changed the moisture regime throughout the entire basin. We have created a situation that we didn't understand would exist by removing the capability of sites to even grow trees at all in a very short time period. That's what is very scary, is that we have actually altered the environment in such a way that it cannot go back and be what it was. As a scientist, that's one of the factors that we always try to keep track of. Have we gone to the point of not being able to go back and recover what was originally here? We are starting to recognize that with our lake systems. They're the easiest for people to see because they can see species no longer existing, the fish being listed as endangered. But we also can see that in other areas with our terrestrial species, but we generally don't think about it too much. We actually have the extinction of the grizzly bear from this area. We have the threatened status of the bald eagle, the endangered status of the peregrine falcon.
When explorers, trappers, and settlers first came to this land, the forest with its great trees stretched as far as the eye could see, and the wood that they harvested for their own use was insignificant. Less than 100 years ago, when the loggers began to cut the great trees, it must have seemed like they would last forever. Then came bigger logging crews, armed with the tools of a growing nation, hungry for raw materials. Their sign, less gentle now, can still be seen upon the land. And at an ever-increasing pace, the demand for lumber grew, and the instruments of its harvest became more powerful. And almost before we could stop and ask ourselves what we were doing, one of the most magnificent forests in the world began to look like this. We can travel through the forest today and see thousands and thousands of acres that have been reduced to a pale shadow of their former glory. The sign of our passing now lies heavy upon the land. The web of life that is the forest is being torn apart. We have taken and given little back, and we say to the earth, heal yourself, and when it does, we go back and take some more.
As a group of species. Woodpeckers are in many ways on the verge of extinction within this area because of the loss of the snag component within the forest condition. The pileated woodpecker, as an example, is at best only going to persist here probably only 10 years. Now, when I say that, it's a pretty scary type of statement. And people would say, how would you make such a irrational statement? What's the basis of that? Well, it's based on the fact that we do not have habitat for that species to exist here. Well, why don't we? Well, when we look at what has been going on for the last 60 years, especially in the last 30 years in this area, there's been a tremendous harvest of the dead or down material out of the forest. And these large woodpeckers, the pileated woodpecker, require this major snag component to exist. And we have eliminated their snags. The mule deer, in many ways, is the same type of example, where we have eliminated the food source for these animals by the way we've prepared the soil after harvesting. The Forest Service, as an example, hasn't wanted to maintain vegetation on the forest floor because it would compete with trees. So when they would clear cut, they would also do site preparation to scarify the land and remove the vegetation that would have been used for forage. In that case, you actually turn an area that was habitat into an area that's no habitat, and it's also an area that the animal can no longer find cover in, makes the animal more vulnerable, and we can really track this over time in that, once again, the young of the species are not able to survive and come into the adult population.
These east side forests were often slow to grow, for moisture was limited and the winters long. But the Klamath Country was interwoven with a network of wetlands and lakes, rivers and streams, and where there was water, a special beauty appeared. But this web of water that feeds the forest and is fed by it in turn, it too is suffering. Much of the wetlands have been drained. We are threatened with the loss of some of our aquatic species. Parts of the Williamson River have had to have its banks repaired. But in other places, they are still broken, and the cooling shade of the vegetation gone. The eagle was sacred to the Klamath people, and now it too is threatened. And when it soars over what was one of the world's great forests, what does it see? In most of the forest below us, the old growth is gone, and in other places, there is terrible devastation.
As we move then toward forest management activities, what we do is we start actually taking out pieces of habitat. And we create a situation that habitats are no longer connected. We're basically creating islands of old growth habitat as we harvest the other, what would have been old growth habitat in the area. We harvest that out, we create islands of habitat. This map represents a quality of old growth habitat that exists on the Wainema National Forest. In the last 30 years, we have really seen that most of the activity has created the pattern of old growth that we see here today. Features that species need to be able to use an environment are the size of the habitat block, the type of habitat that it actually is, and then the spacing between habitat types. The red is an example of a habitat that would be required by pileated woodpeckers. And so as we look at this pattern, we can ask, is this too great a distance for a pileated to move to be able to relocate and maintain itself? Or are these habitat units large enough to in fact support a pair of birds? The colored areas are about 130,000 acres of land out of an area that's close to 600,000 acres of land. So the you're a little more than 10% of the total area is old growth habitat type. What we then need to recognize is, while this is what did exist in 1989 and 90, the direction that we're going is to go to a much smaller retention of old growth habitat. This map is the forest preferred alternative, alternative D, for maintaining old growth habitat on the Wainema National Forest. And it's in compliance with the forest plan, and the forest plan says that it will maintain species diversity over time, and the allocation of these lands to an old growth type will provide, in their opinion, that requirement of the law for species persistent over time. Okay, at this level, what we can see is that of the area that we previously were talking of over 100,000 acres of old growth being retained in the area, we're now looking at only part of this area. This is about a 400,000 acre area, wherein we're going to retain almost 15,000 acres of old growth habitat. You can also very easily see that there's an absence of islands of habitat, as an example in the red, the pine associated type, where we previously had areas where species could move between habitat units. So as an example, this piece of habitat that will be retained under the forest management preferred alternative previously had another piece of old growth here, had another piece of old growth that set in here, had a piece of old growth that was to the south of this. So we are now saying that this area of itself will allow species to persist over time, when in fact there is no opportunity for an old growth dependent species to move anywhere outside of this piece of environment. The rest of the forest will not provide old growth to a sufficient nature to maintain that species, or those species that are dependent upon this type of habitat. As an example, when I talked about the pileated woodpecker, saying that they are basically on the verge of extinction in this area, if the only location they have to maintain themselves in this area is this piece of habitat here, and perhaps this piece of habitat up here, there is very, very little likelihood that these birds will in fact migrate in such a way, or emigrate in such a way, that they will be able to intermix. Secondly, there are factors within this component of habitat here that may have some type of a disastrous effect. For example, a large fire, as has occurred in this area over time, would burn through and maybe destroy most or all of this environment. If such an event were to occur, we would no longer have any pileated habitat left on this entire ranger district of the Wainema National Forest. That's not acceptable, and it also violates the laws that this society has set forth for us to ensure that species persist over time. In summary, when we look at the amount of old growth that we have retained here, you could say, is this enough? And I would say, no, it's not enough. Looking at the red areas again, we would say that to maintain the pileated woodpecker, we need probably 50,000 acres as a minimum. We have 35,000 acres represented at this time, so we're deficit 15,000 acres. The consequence of that is the species will not persist, the habitat will not only be inadequate for the pileated, but for all of the other species that depend on that habitat type. So the decision to only provide 15,000 acres of old growth habitat on the Chiloquin Ranger District of the Wainema National Forest is their direction. And even though there are appeals to the forest plan, those appeals are not going to be heard at this time because of the other controversies that exist in the Pacific Northwest on habitat protection for spotted owls. What that means is, until the spotted owl controversy can be ironed out, the chief of the Forest Service will not make decisions on appeals to the forest plans. Therein, the forest plans stand as the guiding direction for each of the forests through this next year or longer, until we can get some kind of a solution to the spotted owl. That means that we really are only managing for 15,000 acres of old growth on the Chiloquin District, when in fact we need to be providing probably 100,000 acres of old growth on the Chiloquin District. And each timber sale that comes along following the forest plan, following the direction of the Forest Service, will in fact eliminate habitat that's essential to maintain species diversity. It's easy to understand that these habitats, once gone, will never be recovered. They're gone forever. And consequently, the species that exist with those habitats will also be gone forever. It gets to be a very interesting and complicated situation, because for the specific district, the Chiloquin Ranger District as an example, that's putting up a timber sale, they're simply following the direction of the law that they have in front of them. That being, they have a certain volume of harvest that they're supposed to provide from each ranger district, and that volume is in compliance with the forest plan. And so in establishing a certain volume of harvest per timber sale, they're simply following their direction. At the same time, if you appeal that timber sale and you're successful in not having that harvest taken out there, the district is only then required to go and put that volume someplace else. So you're constantly moving around on this checkerboard trying to find a place to harvest the trees that cannot be afforded to be lost because of the devastation it creates to the environment. And so by winning an appeal, you simply move the places. You move the players to another place, and they start working on that location. And if you win there, they move to another location. The problem is we've harvested too much over too short a period of time, and there is no escape from this without either removing the volumes or destroying the environment. The decisions on where we as a society go with the management of our national forests, it's complicated and it's controversial. What we've tried to do is show people that there really are some things at risk, and that without taking some significant action, the risk will not only persist, but in fact we will lose and lose species, lose diversity, and lose stability to the ecological community, probably lose stability to the economic community as well. The decisions on how forests are managed comes from the Forest Service, but it also comes from Congress. And to appeal to the forest without appealing to the congressional members that decide how the forest management activities will take place is only going halfway there. In fact, the forest in many cases simply does what Congress says. And our ability to influence fortunately in this country, is by our voice to those who we elect. Those are the people that follow what we have set before them.
It would be wrong to make the Forest Service or the timber industry solely responsible for the loss of our forests. For who are they but our brothers and sisters and our neighbors and friends? And we all make use of the lumber they have produced. But we cannot go on like before. The clock is ticking. The earth that nourishes us is being destroyed. The laws that protect this land are too weak, and our desire for short-term profit is too great. We are just beginning to wake up and see how priceless and irreplaceable our Klamath country is. And we are seeing it at the very moment when it is disappearing. We hold this land in trust for the people of Oregon and for the people of the United States and for all the peoples of the earth. What are we going to tell our children when they ask us why they live in a land of desolation? Are we going to say that we stood by silently and watched it die?